last week, we had a great group of guys with Hearts for Jesus join us to talk about an upcoming event in Pittsburgh called For Men Only. Tunch Ilkin, JT Thomas, Arthur Motes, and Bill Stern are here to share more about being on Jesus's team on this week's Real Life. And since this is for men only, take it away, Don.
Well, you know, Amy's always welcome,
right.
Tunch, but not to the men's only event.
Right.
This is the men's only time when we get together and we kind of can be transparent and learn. Tell us a little bit more about men's only.
Don, this event is actually Bill Stern's vision, and it started back in the 90s. And the original one was with Rosie Greer, John Kolb, and myself, and then we did a couple more after that, and it kind of lay dormant for a while. And then Bill calls me up 2 years ago, and he says, "Man, I want to get the band back together. I want to get For Men Only back together again." And he and his buddy, and of course Bill's the men's pastor at Covenant Church, and so we started talking. We met for coffee and with Jarrell Gilliam, who was part of Promise Keepers. And we started this event 3 years ago, this is our third one coming up. And JT's going to be there, and Arthur Motes is going to be there, and Will Allen's going to be there, and Calvin Beecham is going to be there. And it's just about, you know, there's going to be music. The Apologetics are there this year, and there's going to be music. There's going to be drama. There's going to be testimony. Most importantly, because Wolf is going to co-MC it with me, Craig Wolfley.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, he's the most famous eater in Pittsburgh, you know. We are going to do tailgating, and that's always a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, for those who are watching that perhaps are new to Pittsburgh, tell us about you guys' careers, your football career. Where'd you play? How long did you play there?
Well, I was with the Steelers for 13 years, and then a year with Green Bay, my last year, 1993. And I went to school at Indiana State University in Terre Haute, Indiana, and was born in Istanbul, Turkey. Immigrated to the States when I was 2 years old with my mom and dad, and grew up a Muslim. But it was here, thanks to guys like JT and John Kolb and Mike Webster and Donnie Schell, won my time with the Steelers. That's where I met Jesus.
As a player. And JT, you were part of bringing the word to him?
I think in terms of the team itself, surprisingly, a lot of guys at that time, which hadn't been spoken of, were basically faith-based and really very dependent on Christ during that era. That's one of the causing reasons we won 4 Super Bowls, but no one, you know, really stated that. They say great coaches, great players, but we had a praying ball club.
So say that again, because I want everybody to hear that. You won 4 Super Bowls.
Yeah.
But what you just said is part of the reason why.
Yeah, like I say, we played together, we parted together, and we prayed together. And when you give men doing that, some strange things happen.
How long did you play here in Pittsburgh?
I played for the Steelers, 9 years, and I spent my last year in Denver. And I was from Florida State University. And I grew up in Macon, Georgia. I grew up in the tumultuous South in the tumultuous 60s doing that arena. So. During that time, obviously, you needed Christ, and I was afraid to let him go.
Well, you grew up in kind of a religious world, but you had the relationship with Jesus that became true and real to you, and you've been following him for a long time.
Yeah, I grew up in the civil rights movement, and as you know, that really was started in the church. So basically, as a young adolescent, being in the Macon, Georgia, Atlanta area, you know, you're familiar with Dr. King and that whole movement, so you're part of it. So, and it was church-based, so obviously your faith was very critical during those, even the Selma era, definitely, yeah.
Yeah, did you see the movie?
See the movie, but that was the epitome of the South in most cities, which you saw in Selma. Matter of fact, I did see it and brought tears because I was 14 when that happened, and the following, when the church was bombed in Alabama, we were afraid to go to church the following Sunday because that was, you know, was one of the target things in the South, was targeting churches, yes.
Yeah, that was horrible time.
It was very horrible, yeah.
Yeah, horrible time. Well, Arthur, now you play now for the Steelers.
Yes, I do.
How'd you get here?
Oh, well, I played my first 4 years in the NFL with the Buffalo Bills. And then prior to that, when I was at college, I went to James Madison University.
JMU.
You're not a Florida State guy, but you know.
I'm just going to Dukes.
But you were in the Shenandoah Valley, though.
Yeah.
You're living in the Valley. That's a good
It's a beautiful
thing.
Place, man. Beautiful place. So, yeah.
And so you came here 2 years ago?
No, this is my first year. I just completed my first season here.
Oh, you did?
So, yeah. And it was a wonderful time for me, man. Like you said, just being able to connect with other men of God, you know, current teammates and, you know, former players and stuff like that. Just being able to see like men, you know, people who have that same goal and that same desire to be more like Christ. I mean, it's just a great feeling. That's why I love it here.
Well, how did you start in your journey with faith?
Well, actually for me, both my parents were pastors. My mother still is a pastor.
Oh.
So I grew up in the church. I'm a self-taught drummer, and, you know, growing up in the church, it was, hey, we need a drummer, you're going to play the drum. So, you know, I always had a love for it, and that was my first introduction to Christ. And, you know, I guess I was saved as a young person, but I didn't really apply it to my everyday walk. It was just, hey, I'm a Christian. I pray, you know. Right. I know what to do. I read the Bible. But as I got older, especially through college and my first couple of years in the pros, I understood that, you know, I'm given this platform being a professional athlete. I should display that. I should, you know, actively apply my faith and, you know, just think about all the lives that I could save by doing that, by being more transparent with myself, even though it makes you more vulnerable because, you know, you're under the microscope now.
Sure.
But that was my whole thing. And I just wanted to just, I guess, help people to understand that you need to have a relationship with God every day, not just when you have an event coming up. We call it game day faith, where you just pray on game day. You pray when you got a big test coming up.
Right.
I try to tell people that you got to do it every day. You know,
I like that game day faith.
Yeah,
I like that, man.
There's the book.
That's right.
There's the book right there.
Very true, man. Very true.
I guess you learn, you know, that grace is free, but it ain't cheap.
Right,
you know,
right about that, man.
Grace is free, but it ain't cheap. How about the praying? Are you? And I don't want to put any on the spot because you're an active player, but are you seeing men in the game right now that are expressing their faith?
I definitely do. And I feel like, you know, with the change of times, it's becoming more, it's not necessarily a foreign thing to people anymore. I felt like when I was in college, if you want to get down and pray, it's kind of like, well, what are you doing? You know, whereas now, people are understanding of that. And most of them will want to join in with you because they don't want to miss out on something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And as an athlete, you're always looking for that winning edge. So to a person who necessarily doesn't have that mm-hmm. great relationship with Christ, if they see me praying, they see Will Allen or Kelvin Beecham praying, well, they're going to want to join in. And then eventually, if that's their introduction, from then on, if they emulate what I do and they see how we, you know, how we carry ourselves, well, now that's gonna, it's gonna, you know, have that mark on them, and then they're gonna start becoming more Christ-like and things like that. And that's ultimately what we're trying to do. We're trying to save lives.
Well, when you played, mm-hmm. and your faith was out front, mm-hmm. people knew where you stood. Mm-hmm. Did that impact the way you could play? Did that change the way you played the game at all?
You know, I think one of the greatest things about coming to Christ is the freedom in knowing that He's in control. And so for me, pressure, you know, the pressure of success and the fear of failure was so, so real. Mm-hmm. And so the freedom to know that, you know, God has given us this gift. I think that's one of the great things about seeing these guys pray after games is they're, you know, they're glorifying the gift giver. You know, I mean, that's what I think is beautiful. In an era when so many guys want to glorify the gift, these guys are glorifying the gift giver. And for us on the out, when I was not a believer, watching these guys, you know, Jesus said, "By this all men will know that you're my disciples, that you would love with." That was the draw.
That's what made you interested.
Yeah.
Now, Bill, tell us about the event for men only. What do you want to see done?
Well, the reason we have the event is for evangelism, to tell others about Christ. But the main thing is about the man. Now, I come from a family, I was the first man saved in my family in 1976. And from that point on, there was 34 people in my family that saved just because God touched one man.
Wow.
So if we can reach one man with the gospel, you know, the statistics say that 95% of the time when you reach the man with the gospel, you got the whole family.
Wow, yes.
So that's why we do it.
Yeah.
The men has to come from the men.
So who's invited? Who can come?
All men.
All men.
All men.
You got to be a man.
Yeah, just come, man. You know, just bring a buddy, bring a guy that's never heard the gospel. Let him get to hear these guys. I mean,
yeah.
It's powerful.
It is.
And there's music, there's speaking, there's food. How long does the event last?
Well, the tailgate's for 2 hours before the event. You go out and get hamburgers, hot dogs, french fries, and you come into the event at 1 o'clock, and it ends at 3.
Well, I went last year.
Yeah.
And I'm coming back this year, and I'm going to invite you to come. If you're a man, there's your qualification, then I want to invite you to come and be part of this. It's completely safe. No one's going to put you into the spotlight. They're not going to jerk you up on a stage and tell us your testimony. But you're going to hear testimonies of lives that have been changed. If you're a wife or a mother and you want your son or your husband to take a step, positive step in life, then send them. We're going to put it on our website, how you can get tickets, how you can find out all about it. So go to ctvn.org, and then you'll be able to connect. And I want to encourage you to do that, because we have opportunities. You know, sometimes there's an opportunity, and that opportunity comes and it goes. If we don't take advantage of the opportunity, we don't get the benefit. So get the benefit, plug in, and let's watch what God's going to do in this event. Thank you, guys.
Amen. Thank you for coming and sharing with us
the beauty of God's work in your lives. You know, because we look up at the players and we go, wow, you know, these are the players. But then we see these are men just like us that love their families and love the Lord. We're so glad that you're coming to share. Thanks for being transparent. We'll be right back.